Are we down to Mark 16, verse 15 and 16? We're actually going to look at verse 16 tonight. And it's important to remember here at the end of the book of Mark, and this passage does belong in the book of Mark. I mentioned to you a couple weeks ago that real famous preachers, they leave this passage out. But this is Mark's account of the post-resurrection commission. And I tried to show you last week, every gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and Acts chapter 1, have an account of our Lord's instructions to his apostles and his disciples after his resurrection and before his ascension. These things are generally, in evangelicalism, it's called the Great Commission. That's a misnomer. That term is not a Bible term. In fact, it's not even a term of church history. That term came into popular existence in the 1800s by missionaries in Asia, India, and China, who were trying to raise money from the United States and England, the British Empire and the United States, to raise money for missions. And it was quite effective. And that's why you see in missionary conferences and churches in evangelical communities today, that term used synonymous with missions. And if you believe in missions, you have to believe in the Great Commission. If you don't believe in the Great Commission, you don't believe in missions. That's got nothing to do with the text that's here. What it has to do with is just the political influence of missionaries trying to raise money. And we're interested in getting the gospel out in every way you can. People say, do you support missionaries? Yes, we do. We have folks from our assembly that have gone out. We have people that we support in other ways. A missionary, though, is generally thought about someone who goes somewhere to preach the gospel. Going to go to a foreign land or something to preach the gospel. I don't think that's a missionary. I think that's a professional huxler, if I say it that way. A missionary is not somebody who goes somewhere and preaches the gospel. A missionary is somebody who preaches the gospel and goes somewhere. And if you can't preach the gospel where you are, don't tell me you're going to go somewhere else and preach it. Preach the gospel where you are, and then tell me where you're going to go and preach it. You understand the difference in that? One guy goes somewhere to preach the gospel. Another guy's going. He's preaching the gospel, going somewhere. Now that's a real missionary. But none of that has really anything to do with the commissions, post-resurrection commissions. Matthew is the gospel of the kingdom, and we didn't go over these things last time. But I tried to point out where they are. Matthew is the setting of Matthew is, "Lo, I am with you always." Even then, he's there with them. He's Emmanuel. It's the kingdom. He says, "Go and preach. Go ye therefore and teach all nations." Israel is not reckoned among the nations. The Old Testament says. So this is a commission where Israel is preaching to Gentiles. It's not a commission to go out and teach every. If you follow Matthew 28 based on what it says, Jesus said, "Teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you." Well, if you do that, then you don't preach to Israel, because Israel is not reckoned among the nations. This is Israel converted in the kingdom under the new covenant. And under the new covenant, he said, Hebrews 8, when he quotes, he says, you don't go. Israel won't say to his neighbor, "Know the Lord," for they'll all know me from the least to the greatest. This is redeemed Israel preaching to the Gentiles. So Matthew's, the legalism, the things I've commanded you, command them to keep the law. The Gentile ministry exclusively, it doesn't really fit what people. People like to pull out the "go ye" and teach, but you leave the rest of it. This passage is the same way. "Go ye in all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned." Well, the people that are going to go preach use that. I've never met a missionary except somebody in either Catholic, Lutheran, or Campbellite that we're going to go tell you that you got to be baptized to get saved. People that use this, they say, he that believeth is saved and should be baptized. But that's not what the text says. So the baptismal salvation, then the signs following, you need to be a charismatic for that, and then you wind up having to be an apostolic to get down into handling snakes and that kind of stuff. So you've got things that people back off from. That's why they leave the passage out. Luke 24 and Acts 1, he says, "Repentance and remission of sins should be preached in all nations, beginning at Jerusalem." Well, nobody begins at Jerusalem. What they do is, to get around that, they say, "Well, Jerusalem's your hometown." Which, get your GPS out, punch up your hometown and see if it's named Jerusalem. get your GPS out and punch up Jerusalem and see if it comes up your hometown. It's not. That's a preacher telling you not to believe the text that you're reading that he says he believes. Beside that, in Acts chapter 1, the apostles, that he says, you'll be witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and uttermost parts of the earth, Jerusalem was not their hometown. They weren't from Jerusalem or Judea. They were from up north in Galilee. The angel that talks to them knew that, because he says to them, you men of Galilee, why stand you gazing? The angel standing there knew where they were from. He knew they weren't from Jerusalem. And if some dumb preacher in the 21st century doesn't know that, that just shows you the ignorance of people that read the Bible, don't pay attention to what the Bible says, just make it up, you know, take their system and go with it. John chapter 20, the authority that he gives them to remit sins and so forth, nobody likes that one except Rome, and people have priests that want to forgive sins, so the Protestants mainly just leave that one out. But none of those commissions, when you read what they say, actually have anything to do with missions today and that kind of stuff. Matthew 28, that kingdom commission is instructing Israel, the little flock, the believing remnant of Israel, what to do in the kingdom. Luke and Acts tell them what to do during the Acts period. Mark's telling them what to do in the tribulation period. John's telling them the authority that they operate on. They're operating in his absence. So you draw a line and you can put them in the places where they fit. Now, they are an amplification of the real Great Commission in Matthew chapter 10, which is the first commission Christ gave them. And that commission in Matthew 10 starts with them right there. He says, don't go in the way of the Gentiles, don't preach to the Samaritans, just go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. It's exclusively to Israel, and that commission starts there. They gather the little flock, they gather the believing remnant out of Israel. And then that commission extends out through Pentecost, when it talks about the Spirit coming, and it extends all the way out through the tribulation to when the Son of Man shall come, all the way to the kingdom. So Matthew 10 is a commission that gives them the whole scope of their ministry. That's the Great Commission. And these post-resurrection commissions now gives them instructions for different spots along the way, time elements along the way, as Christ is the giving them instructions about what their ministry is going to be. And each of the four Gospels kind of reflect all of that. So when you come here in Mark, we're talking about Mark's Gospel. And this is his presentation of the Lord's instruction. And by the way, again, these instructions here and the ones in Luke take place the day of the resurrection. He's resurrected that Sunday morning. They find the tomb empty. This is the evening of that first day of the week, the one in Luke 24 and the one here in Mark 16. So these are the first things that he tells them about, and they have to do with what he's going to doing in his absence. In Luke 24, after Luke gives you that account, he takes you out and shows you the ascension of Christ into heaven. Here, verse 19. So then after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven. So Luke and Mark skip everything from that first day. They go 40 days over, and they give you, he ascends up. That's because these instructions are going to be especially in light of his absence. That's why I said Matthew 28, that's when he says, lo, I am with you. They're especially in light of his presence with them, which would be what the kingdom's about. So verse 15, he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Now, we went over this last week. This is an expansion. In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, he limited their ministry to Israel. In fact, you recall Matthew 15 when the Syrophoenician woman came and wanted him to heal her daughter. He didn't answer her. She went to his apostles, and they came to Christ and said, would you help her? And he says to his apostles, I am not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. The children must first be filled before we cast the bread to the dogs. So in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, in his earthly ministry, he's focusing on the nation Israel. Now, the reason he did that is because he's gathering together the believing remnant out of Israel. He's got to get that believing remnant. If you're not little flock, it's your father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. So he's gathering together that believing remnant who then, after his resurrection, that believing remnant are going to be sent. The Abrahamic covenant had in view the salvation of all the nations. In thee shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. So what you're having here is now the expansion of their ministry into not just Israel, but to all the nations. And that's why Luke chapter 24 and Acts 1, beginning at Jerusalem. The reason for that is that Israel first had to be saved, and then redeemed Israel would carry the message out to all the world in the kingdom. So in verse 15, going into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, this is the ultimate goal, the ultimate purpose, the ultimate aim. And by the way, when he says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, I heard someone just this past week say that water baptism is Jewish. And that's really not true. Because he just told you, preach the gospel to who? Every creature. That's everybody. Includes Gentiles, eventually. He that believeth among every creature. So in the kingdom program, Gentiles get baptized. Water baptism has to do with the kingdom program. It's not just for Jews. It's for Israel's program. But in Matthew 28, when he says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them. Who's that? Gentiles. So if you make a broad statement that isn't true, water baptism is for Israel. Well, it's for Israel's program. But it's not just for Israelis. It's also for... We're going to spend some time studying in verse 16 the issue of baptism, water baptism. But the issue of water baptism is the issue of a cleansing. And just as Israel needs to be cleansed, ceremonially cleansed from their idolatry, so do the Gentiles. And when you see the prescription for cleansing, it always includes the water, the washing, the ceremonial washing. So don't make the mistake of in trying to explain to people what water baptism is about, of just saying, well, it's just Jewish. It's Israel's program, but it's for the kingdom. And its association has to do with them being a kingdom of priests. So verse 16, he that believeth and is baptized. Now here's the proposition. Go in all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That's the gospel of the kingdom that they've been preaching. He that believes the gospel that you're going to preach and is baptized shall be saved. He that believes not shall be damned. So there are three issues in that verse. The proposition... You know, when Paul says in Romans 1:16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also the Greek. The proposition of the gospel is that Jesus Christ died for your sins, was buried, raised again the third day for your justification. Okay? The proposition, that's the gospel. But the proposition of the gospel is, it's the power of God to everyone that believes. So when you tell someone the gospel, you understand the gospel, then what do you do with the gospel? You believe it. And to him that believes, him that works not but believes in him that justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Is your faith resting in Jesus Christ as the one that died for your sins, was buried, and rose again to give you life? The proposition of the gospel of grace is you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. The proposition of the gospel of the kingdom is he that believes and is baptized shall be saved. If you don't believe, if you're not baptized, what happens? You're damned. Now, if he says, so there's three things. So there's believing, there's the issue of baptism, and the issue of salvation. The key issue there is going to be believing. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. He that believes not shall be damned. So you got a proposition. Believe and be baptized, saved. Don't believe, you'll be damned. What's on both sides of the proposition? Believe. So what's the key issue? Believing. Follow that? If you believe, you'll be baptized, you'll be saved. If you don't believe, it don't make any difference what you do beyond that, you're going to be damned. So the key issue in the thing is believing. The essential element is always believing. It's the one on both sides. So you can see that. Now, when it says he that believeth, it's going to be believe the gospel. Come back with me to Mark chapter 1. And it's important to understand the thing about the gospel. There's a little bit of something here I just want you to see. Mark chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Now, if you lived in the first century, that would be a startling statement to read. The word gospel, the Greek word, euangelion, was a word that was used in the first century. The Roman Empire existed when Christ was there, but the Greek Empire that had existed previous to that, the Greek language had become the world's universal language. English is the universal language today. There's a TV show on the television. I don't know what channel it's even on. It's on cable. But I watch it at night sometime when I'm trying to fill up some time. And it's got, they've been playing this program. It's air disasters. And it's an hour-long show about some airplane that crashed or some boat that sunk. But the airplanes that crash, and then they go in and they test, they figure out why they crashed and all that kind of stuff. And you're in Europe, and you're in Africa, and you're in Asia. And you know when a pilot talks to the air traffic controller, you know what language he talks in?
English.
They'll talk all over the world, they talk English. It fascinates me because sometimes I can't understand a word they're saying. And I wonder how they understand each other. I don't know. But they do. And I've been in the Philippines, and the Filipinos sometimes, you know, in the Philippines, there'll be people from five different areas that speak five different dialects, and the only thing in common is English. And I've been there and talked to them, and I can't understand what they're saying in English. I don't know how they understand it, but they do. So I'm happy for that. English is the universal language of commerce and so forth. Well, Greek was that way back in the day of Christ. And that word, euangelion, that word gospel, we say good news, glad tidings of great joy. But if you lived in the Roman Empire, that word was a word that was used to announce the presence of a... If you ever heard it called a herald, a heralder, it was used to announce the presence of someone coming along and saying, "Here comes good." You know, you remember Paul Revere? What was it? The British are coming. He was a heralder. You can see sometime in movies, you know, extra, extra, extra. Read all about it on the newspaper. That guy's a heralder. And what that guy in the first century was heralding would be a military conquest of some general, some political leader, and it was used to announce political leaders and Caesars and that kind of thing. And so it was a common word used in that language to announce Roman authorities. Now, here's the gospel of Jesus Christ, not a Roman authority, not one of the Roman deities, but the Son of God. So it'd be kind of a startling thing when you read this. This is something really new. And when Mark writes that, the Spirit of God has Mark write that, he's doing it to jar and announce, here's something different on the scene, my son. He's the real king. He's the Son of God, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Mark starts out with this bold announcement, Messiah is here. As it is written, he's come to fulfill the prophets. Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare the way before thee. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Here comes Messiah. At the end of the book, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. The gospel of who? The gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel about the Messiah. Now, we've looked at that passage already. It's all through the Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they preach the gospel of the kingdom. And the reason they were preaching the gospel of the kingdom, look back with me over to Matthew. In fact, get Luke chapter 12 in one hand and Matthew chapter 21. The reason they were preaching the gospel of the kingdom, what is that? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Mark 1:15, it says, repent and believe the gospel. What's the gospel? The kingdom of heaven is at hand. That's the gospel of the kingdom. The gospel of the kingdom was not that Jesus Christ is going to die for your sins. They don't even know he's going to die. The night before he dies, they don't know that he's going to die. After he died and is resurrected, they still didn't believe the scripture is going to be resurrected. That was hidden from them. They don't know that until later when he opens their eyes that they might see it in the scripture. So they're not saying Christ's going to die for our sins. They don't even know he's going to die. They're saying he's the Messiah and the kingdom's at hand. Up until John the Baptist, the kingdom is something prophesied. The prophets in the law and the prophets said it's coming. John comes along and says, hey, all that stuff that's been promised, it's at hand. It's right here. It's within our grasp. Why? Because the Messiah showed up. He's the one that's going to bring it. So there's this good news about the kingdom is here. The Messiah is here, and he's bringing with him the kingdom. I was studying today in Ezekiel, and I was struck in Ezekiel 39, where he talks about, I'm going to hallow my name. I'm going to hallow my name in my nation, and I'm going to bring them into the land and set them into the kingdom and fill them with my spirit. And I'm reading that, and I'm thinking, you know what that is? Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Now you hear that all, you've heard that so much of your life that you just kind of, it just goes over, you know. And, you know, dumb, unintelligized preachers, they say, well, you know, that's the king, that's the rule of God in your heart, that kind of stuff. Which is, you know, what does that mean? The issue of our Father which art in heaven, he doesn't belong, in Israel's program, he doesn't belong in heaven, he belongs in the temple in Jerusalem. He's Emmanuel, God with us, not on exile. So the prayer starts out with the wrong thing. Israel being in the wrong position because they're in captivity. He's withdrawn himself from them. Hallowed be thy... He's talking about bring the kingdom. When they say hallowed be thy name, he's saying what Ezekiel 38 says, 39 says, Ezekiel 36, we studied it just last time. We're going to study it some more. Bring the kingdom. Thy will be done on earth. Thy kingdom come. That's all that. So what you have in the gospel of the kingdom is the Messiah is coming, is here, and he's going to bring the kingdom. And you need to get ready, repent, get ready for his appearing. Now, that kingdom, that what John is preaching to Israel, is he gathers together people that believe him, people that repent and are baptized. They go out to John, they repent, confess their sins, are baptized, and they're identified together as that believing remnant. Now, what he's going to do with that believing remnant, Matthew 21, he tells the parable to the Pharisees and to the religious leaders of Israel. Verse 42, Jesus said unto them, did you never read in the scripture, the stone which the builders rejected, the same has become the head of the corner? This is the Lord's doings, and it is marvelous in our eyes. That's Psalm 118. Therefore, I say unto you, that the kingdom of God shall be taken from you, that's the leaders of Israel. You see verse 45, when the chief priests and Pharisees heard his parable, they perceived that he spake of them. He's talking about the Pharisees, the leaders of the nation. Verse 42, therefore I say unto you, the leaders of Israel, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation bringing forth the fruits thereof. Now, what preachers do is they say, well, that means he's going to take it from Israel and give it to the Gentiles. But the problem with that is you didn't read the verse. He said, I'm going to take it from you and give it to a nation, not the nations. The word Gentile means the nations. He's going to give it to a nation. What nation is it that he's going to take it from the leaders of Israel, the apostate leaders, and give it to? Well, if you look at Luke chapter 12, verse 32, and you should have that written down by that verse by now. Luke 12:31, Jesus is talking to his disciples. He says, "But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." So he's going to take the kingdom that he's promised to the nation Israel and take it from that apostate religious, vain religious system leaders and give it to that believing remnant in Israel who are going to be the true Israel of God. That's what the gospel of the kingdom is designed to produce. Now, when you come to Mark 16, that's been accomplished. Now he's talking to that little flock of Israel, the little flock, and he says, now you guys are going to go out and no longer just focus only on Israel, but you're going to begin with Israel, and what you're going to do is your ministry is going to continue out into the kingdom. Now come with me to Acts chapter 2, or Acts chapter 3, and Galatians chapter number 2. Because the terminology for the gospel changes at this point. Galatians chapter 3. 2 days before he died, which would be 5 days before he said the words in Mark 16, Jesus told his apostles, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached into all the world as a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Between that point in Matthew 24 on the Mount of Olives, 2 days later he dies, 3 days later he's resurrected, there's no record of him changing the gospel message. So he didn't come in and introduce the gospel, the grace of God, or the mystery of the gospel. He doesn't change the program. But here he expands the ministry. That's why in Galatians chapter 2, verse number 7, Paul says, this is an account of the Apostle Paul in Acts 15, has gone to Jerusalem, Barnabas and Titus with him, and they've gone to Jerusalem and communicated to the apostles at Jerusalem, the 12 apostles and the little flock there, what he's doing among the Gentiles. And there'd been a doctrinal controversy, and he preaches, he communicated, he goes up by revelation. Christ tells him, go. And he preaches, he communicates them the gospel he's preaching. Verse number 7, contrary-wise, when they saw the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me, as the gospel of the circumcision was unto Peter. Now notice what he calls the message preached to that Peter's preaching. Now it's called the gospel of the circumcision. Verse number 8, for he that wrought effectually in Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision, the same was mighty in me toward the Gentiles. And when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given unto me, they gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship, that we should go unto the heathen, and they unto the circumcision. So that was the conclusion of the matter. I just want you to see, when you after the resurrection and after the coming of the Holy Spirit, Paul refers to Peter, what message Peter's preaching, as the gospel of the circumcision. That's not because the message is changed. That's because the message has been expanded. Acts chapter 3, Peter preaches the gospel in Acts 2 and 3. He preaches the gospel of the circumcision. And what that's about, if you look at Acts 3, verse number 25. You start in verse 18, Acts 3, 18. But those things which God before has showed by the mouth of all his prophets that Christ should suffer, he hath so fulfilled. So prophecies being fulfilled, one right after another. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, and he shall send Jesus Christ, which before is preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive, until the time of restitution of all things which God has spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. Prophecy is just continuing to be fulfilled. For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren, like unto me, him shall you hear in all things whatsoever he shall say unto you. That's Deuteronomy 18. That prophet is the Messiah. And it shall come to pass that every soul which will not hear that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. Yea, and all the prophets from Samuel. And those that follow after, as many as have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. I've often said, every time I read that passage, or most every time, I remember the little nursery rhyme we used to sing to our boys. Peanut man sat on a track, his heart was in a flutter. Round the train, round the bend came the train, toot, toot, peanut butter. You ever sing that to you? You didn't sing that again. You got others you sing. The idea that if you sit on the track and the train's coming, you're going to be peanut butter. That's what Pete's saying. He said he's coming back, and if you don't respond positively to him, you're going to be peanut butter. He's coming. He's going to be either your savior or your judge. And he's going to bring exactly what the prophet said he's going to do. Now, verse 25. Ye, he's talking to Israel, are, not were, the children of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, and in thee shall all kindred of the earth be blessed. That's the gospel of the circumcision. Unto you first, God having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from his iniquities. The gospel of the circumcision is that there's life for all the nations of the earth through the Abrahamic covenant, through the seed of Abraham, through the circumcision. The covenant made with Abraham is called the covenant of circumcision. So that gospel of circumcision is now that it's not just that he's going to save Israel, redeem Israel. He's got the believing remnant in Israel now. And now they're going to go out and take that message of the Abrahamic covenant to the nations. In thy seed shall all the kindred of the earth be blessed. Unto you first. That's why it was first. God having raised him up his son, sent him to bless you. Israel has to be redeemed, and then it goes to the nations. Now Paul comes along, and he's given a message that Romans 11:11, through the fall of Israel, salvation goes to the Gentiles without Israel. So Paul's message has to do with taking us out from under any covenant that deals through where you have to go through the circumcision, and puts us over here. It's the good news for the uncircumcision. Now there's a message that goes straight to Gentiles without any covenants, without any circumcision. And that's part of the message committed to the Apostle Paul. That's the gospel of the uncircumcision. That's a different program. So when you run through those things and you see the different, yeah, the gospel of the kingdom is in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, because it's gathering together. That's why it's exclusively to Israel. He gathers a little flock. Now he sends a little flock out in the early part of Israel, of Acts, to provoke unbelieving Israel to get saved. The gospel of the circumcision. We're going to go out and take the message out. When they reject that, he raises up the Apostle Paul, and that ministry takes the message to the Gentiles without Israel. So when he's saying back over here about going all over and preach the gospel, it's the gospel of the kingdom, but it's in its expanded form, and that's why it's to every creature. He that believes that gospel of the circumcision and is baptized shall be saved. Now, again, the issue is believing. And by the way, it's important to understand why the baptism. We'll talk about that next time because we're going to run out of time. And it's also important to understand the difference, what it means to be saved. Because salvation in Israel's program is not like salvation in our program. When you think about by grace you're saved through faith, that not of yourself, it's a gift of God, that salvation makes you complete in Christ, you're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heaven, and there's nothing to be added because you got it every bit up front. In Israel's program, salvation, almost always, especially in the Old Testament, you see that word saved, it's talking about physical deliverance, not spiritual eternal life. And it's important to understand that, and we'll see that in Acts chapter 2. In fact, since I mentioned it, might as well look at it, Acts 2. In Acts chapter 2, the Apostle Peter interprets the message that he's given. Acts 2, verse 38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from what? This untoward generation. So you're going to repent, you're going to be baptized, you're going to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, and that will save yourself from this apostate generation upon whom the wrath of God's going to fall in the great tribulation. So the salvation they're talking about there, he's talking about here, is a physical salvation from an apostate nation and the wrath of God that's going to fall on them. So this, in Acts 2, he's literally interpreting the message back over here in Mark. So you're getting the thing repeated over there. And there's several things that's going to help there, because there are people, some people take Mark 16 and say the baptism is not water, it's spirit baptism. Well, Peter didn't know that in Acts 2, evidently. So you'd think Peter knew about, he's filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking the Spirit gave him utterance. I'd say he knows more about it than anybody else does. So anyway, go back with me to Mark just for a second. Let me just make one. You got just a couple of minutes. Make one point about the issue about the believing here. The essential element in Mark 16 and in the gospel of the kingdom, the gospel of the circumcision, the essential element, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, he that believeth not shall be damned. Then the essential element is faith. Without faith, nothing else matters. With faith, other things do matter. Without faith, baptism doesn't matter. But if you have faith, baptism does matter. So that's important to get that. But the essential element is always going to be faith. If you don't have faith, no matter what else you do, you're just going about to establish your own righteousness, and that doesn't work. So it's important to grasp the place of faith. And we don't have time to, I want to go through a little bit about that in connection with Old Testament salvation of the kingdom program. We'll have to wait and do that next time. But just understand that the issue that always is there is that issue of believing God's word to you. The basis of justification, personal individual justification before God in any place in the Bible, the basis of it is always going to be the blood of Christ. No one ever stands before the presence of God in the merits of anyone except his son. If you had to, I don't care who you are from Adam on, you can't stand, a fallen man cannot stand in the presence of a holy God in his own merits. You have to stand in the merits of his son. That's the basis of all acceptance before God. The means of connection to that is always faith. It's faith here. Without faith, you got nothing. We read a verse last time over in, if you look with me over at Romans chapter 4. Romans 4, verse number 2. For if Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before God. But what saith the Scripture? God, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. So Abraham had righteousness counted to him, imputed to him, because he believed God. He believed what God told him. If you go down to verse number 22, talking about Abraham, therefore it was imputed to him for righteousness. What was faith? That is not written for his sake only, that it was imputed to him, but for us also to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead. So faith is what caused God to justify, impute righteousness to Abraham. If you go back to verse number 6, even as David also described the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works. So for David, God imputed righteousness to David without works, but based on faith. So that's always the way imputed righteousness, personal imputed righteousness, is always based on faith. It's the means of gain. It's always going to be based on acceptance in Christ, on the merits of the blood of Christ, but you get access by faith. We read the verse last time in Hebrews chapter 11. I've always loved this verse, Hebrews 11, about Noah. Hebrews 11, 7, by faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house. Now, how did Noah's family get saved? They got saved physically from drowning. What did he get saved from? Drowning. So there's a salvation that isn't imputed righteousness salvation. It's not eternal life. It's not a spiritual issue at all. It's don't get drowned. Why? Because Noah believed what God told him. You believe God. Now, what God tells people, what he told Noah, is different than what he told Abraham. What he told Abraham is different than what he tells you. That's the dispensational content. The content of what God says to people at different times, that's dispensational Bible study. That's why that's critical. You can't just go back and say, well, what he told Noah, build a boat, I'll build a boat. But now look at the rest of that verse. By the which, by faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. So where did Noah get righteousness? He got it by faith. And the righteousness that he had by faith gave him an inheritance in God's plan. So when you think about salvation in Israel's program, it's not the law, the works, the things that they did, the baptism, whatever it is, those only have any efficacy, any effectiveness, because they're connected to faith. And they're done because God said it. Now, who justifies people? Romans 8, Paul, God does. God, it's God that justifies. He's the one who imputes righteousness to us, declares us accepted. He sets the standards for that. He's the one that does that. He does it based upon, in Romans chapter 3, verse 25, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation, talk about his son, through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. God could look, when God looked in time past, God knew the cross was coming. Christ was slain from before the foundation of the world. It had been his plan, his purpose. That was the agreement they had before the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. But he didn't tell anybody about it. And why didn't he tell anybody? 1 Corinthians 2, because had Satan known about it, he wouldn't have crucified him. So he kept some information about the cross work secret. But God knew it was coming. So he now is able to declare his righteousness. Now, part of the now time revelation given to Paul is an explanation about how God could remit sins in time past, forgive them, send them away. People, the blood of bulls and goats can't take away sin. Then how could God justly and righteously forgive them? He knew something was coming that they didn't know. Okay? So to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. So God could set up a program, give it to people. The program, the salvation that he has back there has to do with the kingdom. When you think of salvation in Israel's program, it's always about setting up that kingdom. That's why the baptism is important, because that's preparing the believing remnant, the kingdom of priests for the kingdom. Who's he going to make that kingdom out of? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added. You get the things because you're part of that believing remnant. Verse number 26, to declare, I said, this time his righteousness, that he might be just and justify him that believeth in Jesus. That's us. So what you're learning through Paul is how the mystery, the secret that God kept about the cross work, explains how he could remit sins. And when he took Adam and Eve out and took that little animal and made a coat for them, shed its innocent blood and gave them a covering, God knew that was a picture of something he was going to do in the future with his son. They had no idea, but God did. And on the basis of that, he was just in forgiving sin, not putting them in hell, but in forgiving their sins, in remitting their sins, in dismissing, because he knew those sins would be justly dealt with in the future. And when he says through the forbearances, it's the extension of time for the payment of a debt. It's the best definition I can tell you. And what he did is he said, I'll be forbearing. I'll extend time because I trust my son to come and die at Calvary to pay for that. So the issue of faith is critical. And the problem that Israel's having is they weren't believing. Now, what do they need to believe? Well, they need to believe that Jesus first, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. They had to change their mind about the Lord Jesus Christ. He's not an imposter. He is our Messiah. We crucified the wrong one. He's the Prince of Life. We need to change our mind. And we need to trust him as our Messiah and be identified with him as a part of his group. And that will result in us not having the wrath of God on us when he comes back. So anyway, you kind of get scattered in that. I want you to see the issue about faith, the issue about baptism, we'll study that next time, the issue about salvation and damnation. The salvation and damnation in that passage is talking about a physical deliverance of Israel into a kingdom, because that's what their hope was. And we'll talk about that next time, okay? All right, praise the Lord.